Kraus.
Here.
Ms. Meany.
Here.
Mr. Russo.
Here.
Okay, first order of business is our July 16, 2014 minutes.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the July 16th, 2014 minutes.
I will second that. Any discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus.
Yes.
Ms. Meany.
Yes.
All right. We do not have any correspondence or anything pending, so I'll go right to new item one, which is the installment payment tap-in fee. Dennis?
Thanks, Mr. Kraus. I provided the committee with a summary memorandum that details a request that we received on behalf of Mr. James Byrd, Solon resident, owning property at 28935 Cannon Road. Mr. Byrd has approached the committee asking for a request, which would have to go through the full council, to pay the tap-in fee to tap into the Solon sanitary sewer system. That cost is $2,900. He does have the money for the construction aspect of that particular project, but because of financial hardship, does not have the ability to pay the tap-in fee as it's set right now. I did some research. I talked to Mr. Bush. I provided the committee, I think, with one or two examples of prior agreements that the council had authorized. Applying the same principle in terms of calculation of interest and determination of payments. If council would approve a five-year repayment plan, there would be four annual installments of $639.57, final installment of $618.84. We would also execute a formal agreement to go over all the particulars and protect our interest by informing Mr. Byrd that should that there be any delinquency or default, we will then file an assessment with the county. I believe the applicant and his legal representative okay. are here this evening.
Sure. Why don't you come on up, introduce yourself, just in case there's any questions.
Good evening. Alan Hockheiser on behalf of Mr. James Byrd, and Mr. Byrd is here.
Good evening. Thanks,
Byrd.
Any questions?
I don't have any. I mean, Dennis, you did a great job of summarizing this, and I think the simple fact that we've done this in the past, Mr. Bush hasn't objected, something that needs to be done. I think it's important to work out a solution that works for everybody. And I myself, seeing that there were no other questions, I'd actually make a motion here to authorize the finance director to execute a five-year payment plan at an annual rate of 3.35%. Rate of interest to support the $2,900 fee. The annual payment due the city would be $639.57 for the 4 years and a final installment of $618.84 in the fifth year.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Good luck.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Sure.
That goes to council then, right?
Yeah, it goes to council.
And under emergency.
Under emergency.
Yeah. Correct. I forgot to add that. I knew there was a clause I needed to add. So would you accept the second?
I would accept the second.
Okay.
That it's under emergency.
All right, item two is a memo to the committee regarding the repeal of section 23411, sanitary landfill fund. Dennis?
Mr. Kraus, this fund was originally set up when the Solon landfill was operational on behalf of the city. Revenue that was taken in for tipping fees was deposited in that fund, and it was used to pay for a variety of things related to the landfill. Since we now do not own that landfill, our collection amounts are nominal at best. Currently, the fund balance in that fund is slightly over $1,000. We did touch on the subject in the budget hearings and inform the committee and the council that we would be moving to set up a new revenue line in the service department for these particular both revenue and expense lines, and then we will eliminate this fund to take it off the books so we have no further need for it.
So at this point you're seeking the repeal from the committee?
Right. We would just ask that the council repeal the ordinance 234 6.11 that established the fund. This repeal would eliminate it. It's just we'd be booking the entries in different areas in the general fund. And again, because we don't own the landfill, the money coming in the expenses are nominal. We've used up everything that we can. So I would just like to close the fund and reallocate the revenue and expense.
Okay.
I have one question, Dennis.
Yep.
When you have down here, the expenses can easily be absorbed into the general fund, and $200,000 has already been appropriated. What's the $200,000? The budget for landfill? What landfill expenses would we have?
Tipping fees.
Oh, there you're okay. I was wondering if that's what you meant by that.
And
okay.
You remember during the budget process?
Sure. Okay.
What we did annually, because there was never enough, the past 5 or 6 years, there was never enough money in that fund.
Right.
We would transfer money from the general fund.
Okay.
So I said, instead of transferring it, why don't we just move the expense up into Mr. Bandier's line?
I thought that's what you meant, but I just wanted to be sure. Okay. All right. I'll make a motion to repeal section 234.11, the sanitary landfill fund, and move all landfill operations, revenue, and expenses to the service department budget as part of the general fund.
I'll second that.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, item three is an update to the committee regarding the city's investment policy, and believe there will be one necessary change that needs to be made with regard to the Student Loan Marketing Association as a eligible investment. Dennis?
We conducted a review of the investment policy. We sent the policy as it exists right now out to a number of financial institutions, brokers, representatives of the treasurer's office to make sure that nobody would have any issue with the way the policy is constructed. As you're aware, we do send the policy out to anybody that handles depository money or investments on behalf of the city and make them sign an acknowledgement that they're in compliance with all the various regulations that are contained in that. Based on that review, as you said, Mr. Kraus, we're just taking out the reference to the Student Loan Marketing Association as an eligible investment, because as of next month, the revised code is going to be modified to eliminate that in terms of an eligible investment for political subdivisions. And that would be section C1B of our investment policy. Other than that, everybody confirmed with us that the policy was sufficient. The auditors have also reviewed it, so I'm comfortable. This is something we'll do on a fairly regular basis in the future, just to make sure that everybody is aware of what the guidelines are for investment of city monies.
Okay. You need action from the committee regarding the removal?
Yeah, I guess what we'd like to do is have the policy approved, updated as it exists now, because the policy is actually codified in the ordinance,
right?
So we would need to update that,
okay,
to contain the new policy. But the only change is that one change is referenced.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the change to the updated investment policy as outlined in the August 12, 2014 memo from Christina Papa to the Finance Committee.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
All right, item four from R.C. Rizzo to the committee regarding participation in State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Contract, RS902114, regarding office supplies and related supplies and accessories. Dennis?
This is the contract the city procures various supplies and accessories through the State of Ohio's bidding process. It's allowed by our agreement with them to be part of the State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Program. There was a new award of two vendors that was effective August 1st. And RC's memo details how much money he's requesting for the balance of this year be allocated to either one of those companies. One is Bowlines, which is affiliated with Staples. The other is GBEX, which is affiliated with OfficeMax. Basically, what this process allows us to do is to obtain supplies without going through a bidding process, since the bid has already been conducted by the state. So and the prices are fairly reasonable. So RC has asked that the committee recommend the council give us approval up to $20,000 for bow lines and $20,000 for G-Bex under the terms of this contract.
Any questions?
I just have one, Dennis. I mean, there's no problem that actually this started August 1st, right? I mean, we can still get into it, that...
Yeah, we're eligible to participate because of our agreement.
Okay. Okay. I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared to authorize the city's participation in the State of Ohio's Cooperative Purchasing Contract in the amount of $20,000 for Bolins, Staples Business Advantage, and $20,000 for GBEX, Office Max, Office Depot, for the remainder of 2014, and declaring an emergency.
I'll second that.
Moved in second. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus.
Yes.
Ms. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Russo.
Yes.
Okay, item five is another memo from R.C. Rizzo to the committee regarding authorization to sell obsolete equipment. And this is fitness equipment at the rec center. Dennis?
These are two old treadmills that the cost to repair would exceed their value. Neither piece of equipment is in working condition. We would just ask that we be allowed to attempt to get recovery of some monies through an auction on GovDeals. I would like to suggest, too, I know we talked about at some point that maybe next month we bring back an ordinance, if the committee would like. I have a draft of one that I've had for a while that would allow the mayor, the administration, to write off obsolete equipment or bid equipment if it's under $1,000, because these things are probably worth $100.
Okay.
Not that I'm giving a price to anybody out there. But I think for some of the nominal things, and that is the revised code.
Right.
It's $1,000. But we would need a specific ordinance, and it's something that I think I brought up a couple of years ago, and we just never went through on it. But if you'd be okay with that, it could eliminate a lot of...
Right.
These ordinances that have to go to council for pretty mundane items.
Right, and there's no reason to hold things up just to go through the process if we can do that by ordinance.
Right. So I'll include it. I'll put that on the list for next month, the draft of an ordinance for you to look at.
Okay, great. Well, in the meantime, I will go ahead and make a motion to prepare legislation to sell the treadmills via online auction through govdeals.com.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus.
Yes.
Ms. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Russo.
Yes.
Okay, item six, last item under new. It's the, another memo from R.C. Rizzo regarding the GroupWise 24 update, which is the, it's a request, capital purchase request for the GroupWise email system upgrade. Dennis?
The GroupWise email system, which we use here, has not been updated since 2009. The IT department, as part of their budget, had proposed to go through the process to try and acquire a 2014 upgrade. We did get pricing off the State of Ohio Master Contract. It's a Novell product, so we go through Novell. The total cost of the upgrade is proposed to be $25,281.20. We did go out and independently try and obtain quotes for this particular service, not affiliated with the state contract, because if we did find a better price, we could use that. However, the best price we found in doing comparison shopping off contract would be $38,808. So we would like to request legislation to purchase the licensing and maintenance from SoftSmart, which is the Novell distributor under the state contract, in the amount of $25,281.20.
Any questions?
Well, just want to comment. I mean, I really like that you know, beside looking State of Ohio, did check. I mean, I think that's always nice to kind of see, you know, the numbers. And I guess my only other question, Dennis, is looking at this. It starts July 1st, 2014, ends June 30th, 2015. I just want to make sure these prices still will be good.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared to purchase the required licensing, I can speak, and maintenance from SoftMart for the GroupWise email system upgrade through the State of Ohio Master Licensing Agreement in the amount of $25,281.20.
I'll second that.
Moved and second. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Kraus.
Yes.
Ms. Niemann.
Yes.
Mr. Russo.
Yes.
Okay, begin our reports. Item 7 is the municipal income tax collections as of the first 7 months of the year. Dennis?
Thank you, Mr. Kraus. I provide the committee with a memo that summarizes the activity for the month of July and year-to-date activity for all three components of income tax. That would be withholding, net profits, and individual. Just to give some summary, our total income tax collection in the month of July this year was $3.19 million. Our estimate for the month was $3.36 million, so we fell short of that estimate by approximately 5%. Total collections from all sources, all three components, is $24.5 million through July. Last year, we had collected a total of a little over $25 million for the first 7 months. So we're running about 1.8% behind those collections for the comparable year-to-date period. Withholding is $2.37 million in July. Last year was 2.40, so we're fairly close there, which has been the case throughout the entire year. Net profit collections were $501,039. Again, to remind everybody, we had a significant refund we processed at the beginning of the year. So even though we're behind our collections by 15%, if you added in that $500,000 refund, we'd be fairly close there. Individual collections are up 13% over last year. We collected $315,000 in July. Last year, we collected $277,000. The projections for this month, the month of August, is $2.68 million. Last year, we collected $2.63 million in August of 2013. We are very close to our projections. We're within 1%, which is pretty good at this point of the year. So that's a variance of about $34,700 per month for the first 7 months. So that variance is a positive variance. We're above. So based on how things have gone through the year and what we foresee for the remaining 5 months of collection, we're comfortable that our original projection of $40.4 million of net, again, these are all net of refunds, is reliable, and we don't see any need to change that projection.
Thank you, Dennis. All right. Item 8 is the capital improvement. Dennis?
The capital improvement fund, we have two major funds that we use, 421, 491. Right now, we start out the year in 421 with appropriations of slightly over $484,000. As of this point in time, as at the end of July, we had spent slightly under $220,000. So we have approximately $264,700 left to spend for the remainder of the year. We have conducted a preliminary review of what the original requests are and where we at, because we did modify some things, but we're comfortable that we don't need to adjust the appropriations in that account. Similarly, in 491, we started the year at $557,000 of appropriation. We've spent a little under $148,000, so we have approximately $409,000 left of appropriation to handle the prospective purchases through the end of the year. We are waiting for a couple of bills to come in for some things, and there's a number of items that we're trying to follow up to push people on the department level to get going, because they had asked for it and we're three quarters of the way through. So you have some other information there on, you know, in terms of fund balance, how the fund balance has changed over the course of the year. And then at the bottom of that memo are the things, the commitments that we've identified that have not yet been processed as a purchase order.
Comments or questions? Yeah, Nancy, go ahead.
I have a question. For 491, Dennis, the rec pools, I mean, do you have any idea whether, is this, I mean, I'm getting some questions from residents about this, about, is anything going to be done on the indoor pools, or don't you know yet, or?
My understanding is that all the work is to be at least initiated this year, and that's because we're trying to get people to, the people in the departments to realize that, you know, the year's running out, and we have to start.
Right, because I think originally, I know they were hoping, I think, if they were going to close the indoor, that they would have the two outdoor pools available.
Right.
So I just, you know, was wondering if, oh, go ahead, Bill.
Yeah, because I know, was that last week or the week before, they had somebody in there preparing an estimate for the slide.
Okay.
And some other work indoors there, so I know that at least.
That there's some.
Right, there's activity.
Okay.
Just with the time involved in going to council and getting the bids and all that, you know, we want to make sure that everybody does it so that it doesn't get deferred just because of weather and other considerations late in the year, and then it becomes a carryover item, so.
Right.
I'll keep you updated on that.
Okay, thanks.
Item eight, or excuse me, nine, is the 2014 revenue comparison report. Dennis?
This again is a report Christina Papa produces every month, just to give the committee some kind of perspective on where we're at in terms of revenue, how things were originally presented in the budget, and our monitoring of our progress so far. Through the end of June, we've collected for all funds $70.6 million. Last year, we collected $70.8 million, so we're right there in terms of being stable compared to last year. In 2012, that number was 67.9. 2011, it was 65.5. So if you're looking back to compare 2 and 3 years ago, we're up anywhere from $3 to $5 million in total revenue over those periods of time. Total revenue in the general fund was $22.8 million. Last year we had collected $23.5 million, but then there again, that $500,000 refund that would have been transferred through did not appear, so it kind of skews the comparative numbers. In 2012, we had collected $20.9 million through July in the general fund. In 2011, that number is 20.5. So we're, again, about 10% above where we were in those 2 years, in 12 and 11, and we're fairly close to where we were last year. So the revenue side of things looks good. Then, as Christina's done in the past, she's given you some comparative differences in terms of each individual department as to where they're at compared to prior years, just to let you know that we're keeping an eye on individual items within the budget to make sure where we're at.
Question?
In Water Rec, what was the surcharge? How much was the surcharge that was posted in 2013?
I don't know, Mr. Russo, off the top of my head, but it's multiple
right.
periods.
Correct. Yeah, because I know the decrease is a little over $500,000, and the sewer billing was down 269. I'm just wondering if there's more than just that difference as far as the sewer posting or the surcharge posting.
I will find out for you.
The other thing too, I'd just like to mention, despite all the weather issues we've had, Grantwood's only $17,000 in revenue. I mean, that's fairly good considering. And then on the Art Center, you know, we say there's an increase in revenue of $37,000. What was meant by the, in parentheses there, with the removal of transfer amounts? Are we saying?
Because this year we transferred all the money at one time, whereas
right.
last year we did periodic transfers.
Right.
So we're just trying to line things up
okay.
as close, apples to apples, as prior years. The sewer surcharges, it's on, fortunately, pages aren't numbered here. But for year-to-date 2014 is $314,000.
Mm-hmm.
Last year we collected, I'm sorry, it was 235. Last year it was 572.
Okay.
So it's a little more than double what it is this year. So
okay.
It's $237,000 difference approximately.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Because that's a fairly substantial drop in revenue. I mean, just even just the sewer billing.
Right, that would be my question.
So I guess I don't know how much of a deficit they're going to be running, because we have a lot of fixed costs in Water Rec. So I don't know what ends up happening when that department runs a negative balance.
Well, there's sufficient fund balances in both those operating funds that they have, so I don't think that's really a concern there in terms of some kind of temporary shortfall.
All right.
A lot of it, too, is the timing of the collections in the years and when the bills go out.
Okay.
We're just in the process now of preparing a list of delinquent accounts to send to the county to get certified for assessment.
Right.
So that balance has gone up a little bit, so there's more people not paying.
Right.
And it takes longer to collect that money through the property tax process.
But this was one, this year we did not increase sewer charges, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. I guess the other question is, because we do get a lot of revenue from the industrial area, right?
Correct.
So I'm just wondering if we're missing anything, if it's a residential issue or a industrial issue.
Well, there has been a number of companies that have changed hands and moved in and moved out, fairly significant accounts, so I'm sure that accounts for some of it.
Okay.
I mean, I would just echo Bill that, you know, the one thing that kind of jumped out was the sewer billing collection being down. You know, it's a considerable amount of money. So.
And the majority of that is going to be that charge that only occurs every several years.
Right.
So I think from an overall standpoint, while we're running a little bit behind last year, I don't think it's a material amount.
Okay.
Okay. All right, brings us to item 10, which is the current year expense through July 2014. Dennis?
Again, this is a monthly report now produced by Corey Weibensinger. Just to summarize where we're at through July, we started out with appropriation for all funds of $114.4 million. The total appropriations for all funds right now is $42.6 million. We have $10.65 million in open encumbrances as of July 31st. And making adjustments again for transfers, because that way we're just comparing expenses to expenses. We've expended a little under 45% and encumbered 15.6%. And on a percentage basis, we're 58% through the year at the end of July. So that's a favorable match up, because those encumbrances cover a lot of things in the last 4 months.
Right.
In terms of the general fund, we started out the year with a $36.7 million appropriation. We have available appropriations of a little over 12 million, with provisions for $2.8 million in open purchase orders as of the end of July. Again, removing transfers to get a better comparison, we've expended 52% and encumbered 9%, so that totals about 61. And we're through 58% of the year, so that again is lines up favorably. We already talked about the capital funds. The only thing that's different that wasn't included on the operational capital funds is the infrastructure fund. That's the year started out with an $11.8 million level of appropriations. Total available as of the end of July is a little over 5 million. And we have another $5.37 million in open purchase orders that relates to a variety of major street projects. And the detail is there in terms of per lines for each department and fund. So if anybody has any questions, I think all in all, we're in a good spot right now. We're pretty much on target with where we should be in terms of both revenue and expenses.
Questions? Okay, item 11, which is the gross payroll comparison report. Dennis?
Again, this is a monthly report, basically just for informational purposes, so you can see where we're at. Obviously, the payroll goes up in the summer because of the number of part-time and seasonal positions that come on the payroll. Corey has given a detailed chart that gives payroll data for each pay period. The most recent payrolls in July, those would be the 14th, 15th, and 16th pay periods of the city. We spent $953,000, $914,000, and $980,000 for each one of those to bring the total through July to its current level of $14.1 million. Last year, our total payroll expense was $22.59 million. So we're projecting to be a little bit above that this year based on the per payroll expense so far.
All right. Any comments or questions? All right, lastly, item 12.
Oh, sorry. No, just looking at our last, the 16th one, Dennis, last year it was 890. See, I mean, it went up almost 100,000.
That could have been, there was two people that left, so it's termination payouts.
I was almost going to ask, does that play into then?
Like sick leave payout, vacation payouts.
Okay, that's what I kind of thought.
I should say vacation payouts.
Okay.
All right, lastly, investment and cash report, Dennis?
Again, this is a listing of all the individual investments and cash balances that we have on the books as of July 31st. It gives you the original purchase date, maturity dates, interest dates, appropriate CUSIP number information. We really only had one big transaction during the month when some of our notes were called. So we're in the process now. We do it once a month, go over, see where we're at. And we just looked at some things today to kind of fill some gaps. We can only go out 5 years, but I think we're looking to shore ourselves up in the 2 to 4 year range. But I'd be happy to answer any questions about the individual components of the total. The total cash and investments at July 31st was $59,647,102.
Comments or questions? Okay, I think that would be it. Unless anyone else has anything on the agenda?
I have a couple of things just for notes. We will be moving forward at some point in September or October with like a first preliminary budget adjustment just to clean up some areas. Two things I wanted to make the committee aware of. Rob Franklin's indicated that he's going to need additional money to cover that inspection contract that he had. Because of the number of rental inspections and plumbing inspections. He was estimating at the beginning of the year that it was about $50,000. That's what we put in the budget request. He's now informed us that by year end, he'll probably spend $70,000. So I just wanted to give you a heads up that that'll be one of the components that we might have to adjust for. And the Art Center, too, is attempting to put together another season of the Solon Philharmonic Orchestra. And they're going to get some additional revenue from the Solon Foundation, which has agreed to supply the Art Center with some revenue in terms of a donation. We probably will need some additional monies for that. And we might need to adjust the expense line to increase to cover that. And I know we were, this was like a first year of kind of revamping the Art Center and all the accounting. I'm not sure that we're going to need that, but I just don't want it to be a surprise. I don't anticipate it being more than perhaps $5,000, but just to let you know. Right. And happy birthday to Barb. Today's your
birthday. Happy birthday, Barb.
Barb.
Better reason, let's get out of here.
Right.
I
made it a short meeting for you, Barb.
That's good. Right. Thank you.
If we would have known, it would have been shorter.
All right, we're
I'll
ready?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion second. Roll call.
Mr. Kraus.
Yes.
Ms. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Russo.
Yes.